Hey there guys, today we'll talk about a brand new missile unveiled by Turkey just a few days ago, and everybody's talking about it, okay? It's called Cakir, which in Turkish means kind of like the color bluish-green, okay? It's similar to turquoise. So with Cakir being a sea-skimming anti-ship missile, mainly, I guess they picked a pretty clever name for it. It was designed by Roketsan, which is a major manufacturer of many other types of missile systems. They're located in Ankara, the capital, with multiple facilities and offices throughout Turkey, of course. They unveiled the Cakir missile in an international press briefing attended by many journalists, and it took the Turkish defense enthusiasts, like myself, by storm. Suddenly everybody's talking about it, like all over the forums, all over YouTube, all over the web. I would say that it became the main event overnight, actually. But there's a few good reasons for that, and we'll talk about that. But before I go on, I need to remind you that what I'm about to tell you about this new missile system is publicly available information that anyone can research on their own. Okay, I do not have access to the complete fact sheet about this missile. I don't have access to like top secret information by any means. I'm only relaying what Roketsan itself shared about the missile, plus perhaps a few bits of personal opinion and speculation that we as Turkish defense enthusiasts discuss in certain forums and social circles. Now, with that said, let's get started and get to know this missile, this brand new missile. First of all, we do know that Cakir was developed at the request of the Turkish military, which needed a smaller missile than the Atmaca anti-ship missile, which is also a pretty famous missile system by now, which as a direct competitor to the US-made Harpoon is quite large and expensive, as you would guess. They needed a lighter, cheap, expendable missile that they can fire in large numbers, especially for saturation attacks. As we all know, in war you run out of missiles incredibly quickly, right? So as we've seen in many conflicts, and like most recently in Ukraine actually. So unless you have large numbers of missiles tucked away somewhere, or you're capable of producing them yourself quickly, you're going to run into trouble finding enough ammo to spend, really. Now, one large factor, of course, is price. You want a cost-effective missile system that gets the job done without collapsing your whole economy in the process, right? They also wanted a smaller missile that can be carried and fired from many different types of platforms, but especially UAVs like Turkey's Akıncı and Muse jet drones produced by Baykar, the maker of the infamous TB2. And we all know about TB2. This new missile is a little over 3 meters and weighs close to 300 kilos. The exact figures are variable, of course, and actually depend on missile configuration. Needless to say, Cakir will be a truly cross-platform, capable of being fired from F-16s, Hürkuş, Hürjet, Turkish 5th-gen stealth fighter, the MMU, also known as TFX, as well as helicopters like SH-60C AUK. By the way, in that regard, Cakir will actually replace the Penguin missiles of the Turkish Navy. It can also be launched from sea and land-based launch platforms. Speaking of launch platforms, we have to mention the fact that it reportedly has advanced network-centric capabilities. For example, one platform can launch the missile and then hand the control of the missile to another platform mid-flight, in the middle of the flight. This is very useful in certain scenarios involving multiple branches of the armed forces. For example, if you want to launch the missile from a naval craft and then hand the control over to an airplane, perhaps because there's like an enemy submarine or something like that in the area. The missile maintains a data link to both the launch platforms as well as to other Cakir missiles in the vicinity, which combined with advanced sensors and piloting algorithms allows the missiles to attack as a swarm, as like a bunch of mini missiles. This was another important design feature requested by the Turkish military, by the way. They wanted a swarm-capable missile that they can use for saturation attacks. Another important point we have to make is that Cakir has a modular design. In other words, it has interchangeable components that can be customized depending on the carrying platform, the mission, and of course the nature of the target at hand. For example, it has three types of guidance kits: an imaging infrared IIR seeker, It has an active radar RF seeker and also a dual mode seeker that features both an imaging infrared sensor and a radar transceiver. All the versions have radar and barometric altimeters, as far as we can say. Also a laser gyroscopic navigational unit and a GNSS sensor that allow the missile to function in locations where the enemy has strong electronic jamming. A frequency hopping encrypted data link enables network-centric features like missile handover to another platform, mid-course target updates, waypoint updates, telemetry, swarm logic, and of course live video confirmation. Cakir also enjoys advanced algorithms that allow it to work effectively in fire and forget mode. Operators manually can set 3D waypoints for the missile to follow, or allow the missile to determine its own path to the target, depending on what sort of countermeasures it'll detect along the way. This is useful in areas where the enemy maintains strong defensive positions and poses a credible threat to the launching platform. Cakir can lock onto a target before launch or acquire one after launch, given a set of programmable criteria. In this mode, it flies to an area of suspected enemy activity and then switches on its imaging infrared or radar seeker to lock onto a target. If it detects countermeasures like a close-in weapon system or anti-missile missiles like RAM, very famous rolling airframe missile, it will perform evasive maneuvers to escape the countermeasures. Now, because Cakir sensors lock onto the whole target, I should have said, the whole target image, instead of a singular heat source, it is immune to simple flare-top countermeasures. This is an advantage that comes with an imaging infrared sensor rather than just using a regular thermal sensor. Cakir can also do terminal phase top attack, which in some cases ensures higher effectiveness. If it encounters multiple targets, it strikes the target that it automatically determines to be the most valuable. You would probably ask, so how does it determine target value? Well, it determines target value by comparing the infrared image against a signature database. Okay, a signature database. If it's flying as part of a Cakir swarm, the missile will coordinate and automatically pick different targets to strike instead of attacking the same target again, unless otherwise instructed by the operator, of course. These are all like programmable criteria. If it's required to hit the same target again, it will hit a different key part of the target to maximize overall target damage. This saves valuable resources and increases the missile's net kill ratio. So it's a very useful feature that they programmed in. Cakir is powered by the KTJ 1750 turbojet engine made by Kale, which is a Turkish industrial conglomerate based in Istanbul. There is also a rocket booster for versions fired from sea and land platforms. By the way, Kale manufactures many high-tech aerospace products, including parts for the American F-35 stealth fighters. The booster helps the missile achieve enough momentum for the jet engine to kick in and work properly. Of course, that's what boosters do. Of course, this is not required for the air launch version, as the aircraft will already have enough energy in the forward vector. This missile reportedly has a cruise speed of 75 to 85% of the speed of sound. So it's a subsonic missile, but still fast enough to challenge most countermeasure systems, especially when launched as a swarm, as part of a group of Cakir missiles. Cakir is reported to be a sea skimming missile that can dip below 1 meter, guys, below 1 meter in proper sea state, of course, which makes it very hard to see and kill by enemy radars and countermeasures. You see, radars on ships cannot really see beyond the horizon, right behind the water table. So if you keep your missile as close to the water as possible, it'll be very difficult, if not impossible, for enemy radar to detect it. Sure, the radar may eventually detect the missile, but the idea is to make that happen as late as possible. This way, the ship won't have enough time to activate countermeasures or warn other ships about an ongoing missile attack, where even a few seconds make a huge difference and determine the outcome of the strike, of course. Like I mentioned before, Turkey wants to use this missile in many platforms, but especially unmanned aerial vehicles like Akıncı and the Muse jet. And interestingly, also unmanned sea vehicles of various types, most likely including the recently introduced Ulag, as you can see from the video. For example, an Ada-class corvette, the Milgram program Ada-class corvette, can remain in safety of air cover and drive a satellite-controlled Ulag unmanned sea vehicle several hundred kilometers ahead of itself in disputed waters. And the Ulag can fire and steer multiple Cakir missiles up to maybe like another 100 kilometers into enemy territory and destroy targets without like ever putting any friendly soldiers in harm's way. I mean, how cool is that? The same scenario is also possible for Turkey's many air platforms with even longer ranges. So we're talking about like hundreds and hundreds of kilometers into enemy territory without risking any friendly soldiers, which is really, really cool. But of course, this is the advantage that comes with using technologically advanced unmanned vehicles and utilizing the principles of network-centric warfare. So Cakir likes attacking ships, sure, but it's not just an anti-ship missile. It is also designed as a land attack missile, right? It can easily be launched from the back of a truck and used as a surface-to-surface missile. In fact, it doesn't have to ever fly above any body of water whatsoever. Why? Well, that's because Cakir has a radar-assisted TARCOM terrain following feature. It carries a digital 3D map of the whole world, of the whole globe. So what it does is it compares the radar image of the terrain with that of the 3D digital map, and instantly determines its location, its exact location, and figures out how best to approach its target while awaiting enemy radar and countermeasures. Even if it loses its satellite navigation signal and the data link to the launch platform, it'll still know where it is, navigate to the target and find it, and with the active sensor feedback, and try to destroy it. It is a 70 kilogram tandem warfare developed by TÜBİTAK SAGE. This warhead was primarily designed with destroying ships in mind, of course, but once it reaches the target, a proximity fuse ignites the primary charge, which opens a hole in the ship's outer skin. Then milliseconds later, the rest of the missile passes through the hole with the main charge and detonates it inside the ship. This creates a positive pressure wave within the metal confines of the ship, and of course causes a lot of destruction. This type of tandem warfare isn't very effective against fortified buildings, of course, but it's very lethal against vehicles of all types, including of course air defense systems, as we can see from the video. It was also reported a few days ago in the Roketsan revealed that the missile may have an optional thermobaric warhead, special designed for destroying enemy buildings. Thermobaric warheads, as you know, use special fuel air mixture compounds to knock down walls with immense pressure while sucking out all the oxygen in the environment. So they have that double impact effect. Anyway, Roketsan says that they will begin testing the missile later this year, and it'll likely begin entering Turkish Armed Forces inventory in 2023. Many Turkish defense analysts consider Cakir a game changer for the Turkish Navy because it'll allow the force to apply new advanced concepts of warfare. Needless to say, Turkey plans to not just use it itself, but also export the missile to friendly and allied countries at extremely competitive prices. These missiles don't just offer an alternative to Western and Eastern competitors alike, they now lead the charts in terms of not just price, but capability as well. Guys, it's considered the cutting edge in missile technology at this point to fit so many electronic sensors and software algorithms and a whole jet engine and a 70 kilo tandem warhead into a relatively small missile. I mean, this is the cutting edge, okay? It's basically like a flying computer with a freaking jet engine and a warhead attached. So my guess is it'll be an export success, just like many of Turkey's other defense solutions out there. And with that, I'm going to conclude the presentation, guys. Thank you, everyone, for giving me your time to learn about this new missile system. I will follow this program and make a new video as more information becomes available. So please like and subscribe and share the video as you wish. And if you have any questions and comments, please do let me know in the comment section. I'd love to follow up with you. So thank you so much for tuning in, guys. I love you. Have a great day, and I'll catch you in the next one.